celebrate.
I thought I had this on. Now, do I have it? Now I have it.
Hallelujah.
As we celebrate this first Sunday of Christmas, we also are at a threshold of a new year. This is a moment in time where we are able to look back over this past year, evaluate our accomplishments, and see what we have left undone. It is also a time for anticipation of what this new year is going to have in store for us. Now, some of the events we are waiting for, such as my time is now winding down with you, and in about 2 months I'm going to be moving away. And as you are saying goodbye to me, you will also be saying hello to your new settled pastor, Reverend Glenn Rice. Likewise, there are unknown events as well, especially for me. I know I'm moving, but the unknown is I don't know where yet. I have a kind of idea of where I'm going, but that's not firm up. Life is filled with unknowns, and yet we usually have some idea as to what the direction will be. For example, the Christmas story started with a promise made by God to both Joseph and Mary, and that the child that Mary was carrying was going to change the world. That would be the general knowledge that this couple had. They did not know the particulars of how their son Jesus was going to change the world, however. The story then continues to address the promises of God with the introduction of Simeon and Anna. Both Anna and Simeon are described as very devout. Anna is said to have spent day and night at the temple, and that the Holy Spirit was upon Simeon. This morning, I would like us to focus on what Luke is trying to share with us through both Simeon and Anna. Theologian Fred Craddock, which, by the way, was one of Reverend Larry Deach's professors, so I mean, I'm amazed that I know somebody who actually knows Fred Craddock. He said of Simeon and Anna, they represent Israel in miniature, and Israel at its best. Devout, obedient, constant in prayer, led by the Holy Spirit, at home in the temple, longing and hoping for the fulfillment of God's promise. Like the words Simeon spoke to Joseph and Mary after seeing their son Jesus, that now he could die in peace, it sparked a memory of something that my grandmother once told me when I was little, when I was about 5 years old. Shortly after my grandfather had died, I must have been moping around the house a lot and probably started to cling a little more to my grandmother than what I would normally do. And so one day, as we were out on the front porch swing, she asked me, she said, "Steve, what's wrong? Why are you so down?" And I blurted out in tears saying, "Grandma, I don't want you to die like Grandpa did." Very common thought, I think, for a five-year-old. And she stopped swinging. And, you know, when we were in the swing, I'm usually leaning up against her shoulder and her arm would be around me. And she turned me around to face her. And she said in a very stern but loving voice, "Stephen, I'm making you this promise. I'm not going to die until I have seen all of your children born." That's quite a promise. And she was able to keep that. She didn't pass away until my youngest daughter was about 3 years old. So, but in her making that promise, It put away all of the anxiety that I had, and I grew up never thinking about her dying again. Simeon was a man who lived in faithfulness to God. And he must have had a certain amount of anxiety about his people, because God had made a promise to him that his life would not end until he saw the hope of Israel. Scripture tells us that Simeon, guided by the Spirit, came into the temple. When Simeon saw Mary and Joseph with their newly born son, Simeon took the boy into his arms and he blessed the child, for he recognized Jesus as the promised Messiah. Simeon was now able to die in peace, for he recognized God as having kept the promise made to him. Now, Anna is also a very devout person, devoting her life, her entire life, to prayer and fasting at the temple. And when Anna sees this baby Jesus, she doesn't say anything at the temple, at least as recorded. But we are told that she left the temple and told everyone that she saw about her experience of encountering the long-awaited promise of Israel. So here's my take on this morning's scripture and how we can apply it to our own lives. Simeon is this man of faith. He is a truly spiritual person, living his life through the guidance of the Holy Spirit. He goes to the temple prompted by the Holy Spirit to be a witness of what God was doing. He has to go to the temple in order to recognize that his promise made by God was being fulfilled. That of having the comfort, the knowledge that Israel's consolation has arrived. He finds such joy and comfort in seeing God's hand actively working that he now says he can die in peace. The other side of the coin, we see Anna, also a religiously devout person who lives at the temple. She never leaves. Scripture says she's there day in and day out. When she sees Joseph and Mary with their son Jesus, she is so overcome with joy. Seeing that God is keeping promises made, she leaves the temple. I don't know if you had picked that up in the reading. Lives there day and night, never leaves. She sees Jesus. She leaves the temple and is sharing that good news about God and how he is actively working in the world to everyone that she sees. What I see in Simeon and Anna are two examples of how we work out our faith. We at times need to come to God's house where we can work out our faith, where we can encounter God in a spiritual space. And then there are times that we need to take our knowledge of what God is doing and go outside of God's house and share that good news with everyone we meet. The truth is that the world would never have known what God was doing in those early days of Jesus' life if people like Simeon and Anna would not take the time to listen to God or make the effort to share with others the good news that they were experiencing. Reverend Catherine Matthews, who happens to be one of our writers at the denominational level, gives a pertinent reflection regarding Anna and Simeon that I want to share with you. She asks this question: what would it mean to Port Orange United Church of Christ to recognize the newborn baby as the one who reveals God's dream to
the world. What would it mean to us in this congregation if we recognized the newborn baby as the one who reveals God's dreams for this world? Perhaps we see only the baby right now and need to be able to dream of what is yet to come. Crossroads, our dream of what is next to come. Think about our children's children, the ones who will someday become the doors to the wider church, long after we are gone, to rest in the arms of God. We are their ancestors. Akira, I'm your ancestor. And they are our heirs. Those heirs of ours will look back, and they will hear the stories of how we, in these days long ago, dreamed of them and built up this church to be a place of warmth and open welcome, a place of justice and love, a place where we all move over and make room for every single person, a place that can be a home where we sincerely tell each new person, we have been waiting for you. This morning, we have moved over to welcome 5 new people into our fellowship as members. And the privilege to see 3 people being baptized into the fellowship and the care of our faith family. We have experienced a part of God's promises this morning. Amen.
Amen.
What goes on in the house of God is critical to what is shared in the world. Remember that. What goes on in the house of God is critical to what the world can learn. As we greet the new year, let us continue to sing the praises of Simeon and Anna as we recognize God's promises in our own lives. Let us take time now for prayer. Loving God, the year is ending. There has been horrendous tragedy throughout the world this year.